everybody.
Gene Roddenberry's idea of what the world
could be at its very best. But they come from the, they come for the explosions and the space shots and all of that. So they may not be into the same things that the Star Trek fans who watch the TV series, the original TV series, and the Next Jet, etc., were. Nevertheless, there are still an awful lot of people who seem to identify with what we were saying, what the show was saying philosophically, what the idea of those seven people on the bridge represented in terms of our culture and our sense of humanity. I'm always have people to talk to. I always have people, even though it's 35 years later or whatever, there's always people that I can feel comfortable with, that I can feel that they were family, you know, and this is what it's supposed to be about. I wish the rest of the world was that way. But Star Trek fans are amazing.
A man that probably wouldn't have gone to a con for free, so hopefully I'm not doing these for free anymore. I'm thinking no, and you know, it's well worth it. Those words were cold, for sure.
Yeah, no, I don't do it for free.
It's a reasonable cost, for sure. To be a legend, I think it's a very reasonable cost. I remember at one point, you know, these conventions were kind of cliched, right? But look at us now, man, you're like Elvis.
Something that, you know, we brought them out into this, in the different series. We brought people, diverse people, Asian Americans. We brought all sorts of people in, and the fans started to reflect the people that we had on the show. And that was great.
Absolutely. You're up first. Go for it.
Hi, Walter. Stephen Fothering from Austin, Texas.
Oh, Austin is a great city.
It is?
Despite it's in Texas, it's a great city.
That light is beaming.
In addition to playing Chekov, you also wrote an episode of the 1973 animated series, The Infinite Vulcan, that had the giant Spock clone. I just wanted to ask you, are you aware that the current animated show, Star Trek Lower Decks, they actually showed the skeletal remains of dead Spock 2. Did you know that? And how do you feel about that?
No, I did not know that.
That's cool.
All 25 feet of him? Or?
Yeah, he's on display in a museum, dead.
That's amazing!
That's a good question.
Fun, except that I didn't know that Gene Roddenberry was so deeply involved in every single episode that was written for Star Trek. He had a hand in the writing, no matter how brilliant it was to begin with. He had that, and it's his baby, and I guess that was his prerogative. So every writer who wrote for the series, for the regular series, had to deal with the fact that they were going to be rewritten and they were going to be asked to rewrite their own rewrites. So when I had done three or four versions of the animated Star Trek Infinite Vulcan, and I started getting notes to do rewrites, and I got to the point where I had done seven rewrites and thought that this was just unique to me. And I must really be a really shitty writer. I thought I could do this. I finally said, no, I'm not going to do anymore. I did not make any enemies for doing that, which is interesting. Bless their hearts, these people are all good people. Dorothy Fontana and David Gerald and all the folks who were involved in the animated show. Yeah, what was the name of the series?
Land of the Lost.
Land of the Lost. Yeah, I wrote one of those. Anyway, what was the hell? What was the question? See, this is every 5 weeks over. No, I didn't know. I did not know. You just told me something I didn't know. I didn't know that Enoch was such a popular character, that they brought him back on Land of the Lost. I didn't know that. So, and then on a more serious note, several people who I adore, who were associated with either Star Trek or Babylon 5, passed away, and I didn't know it for months and months. You know, it was all new to me. Let's get back on cheerful.
Yes. Yes.
Your question.
Hi, I'm Gary from Chicago.
Yeah.
When Star Trek 2009 was being made, did Anton Yelchin reach out to you for any advice on how to play Chekov? And if so, what did you tell him? If he didn't reach out, how do you feel about his performance as Chekov?
It's a good question. I met Anton. I was invited to watch them shoot the first Star Trek movie, the new one, and I came down, and he wasn't working that day, but they called him, and I think he was living in Malibu. He was living quite a ways away, and he came to the set, and we sat and we talked for a couple of hours. A really neat young man, a really sweet, good guy. I truly enjoyed the time we spent together, and it was fun to see him do the fake Star Trek, Walter Koenig Russian accent, and he was a real Russian, you know. Bless his heart that he did that. And what a tragedy! What a total tragedy!
Yeah,
I mean. He had, as young as he was, he had over 60 credits in film. He worked with Sir Anthony
Hopkins.
Hopkins, right. Delightful guy. In fact, I was invited to the premiere, and I went with some, not reluctance, but some doubt, some question in my mind how I would respond to watching a whole new group of people doing our show. And I didn't know, because I can be petty. And I didn't know how I was going to react. I ended up thoroughly enjoying it, thoroughly enjoying the new Kirk. And well, there's nobody who's ever going to be Mr. Spock, as far as I'm concerned, except Leonard.
Yes. Yes.
But there's 1,000 actors in Hollywood for each of our roles. For Dr. McCoy, and for Scotty, and for Chekhov. So, you know, I was tickled to watch these folks work. I thought they were all great. I enjoyed the story. Performances. My other little anecdote is that after it was over, and I was pleased with myself that I was so generous. I really thought maybe the bad Walter Koenig would come out. But I'm walking. They had rented this parking lot because there were so many people there, and everybody, all the actors, had a group of fans, and journalists, photographers. Crowded around them, and we were walking through, and I hear, "Walter, Walter," and I look up, and there's Anton with a group of people around them, and saying, "Walter, I have my own Chekhov doll." Does not describe Star Trek fans. I mean, they may be engineers and and no computers, more than the average population, but they're, bless their hearts, they're very dimensional folks. They have lots of adventures. I have conversations all the time, and they're very stimulating. I don't classify Star Trek fans as being one thing. They're not just one thing.
Well said. Well said. Did you have a question?
Yes, I'm a Star Trek fan, so Star Trek fans have to be cool, so. Okay. I'm here, so you know, I gotta be cool.
Oh, yeah.
But this is my first ever Star Trek convention.
Welcome.
And I know it's obviously it's not your first convention, but I wanted to know, out of all the conventions you've been to, is there one year or one specific convention that stands out as the best, you know?
Interesting question. Probably not, but there's a group of collections, a collection of conventions that stand out. First of all, the Vegas conventions stand out because they're only Star Trek fans there. I mean, it's really a captive audience. You cannot do wrong. I mean, a convention like this, you've got everything. You know, you've got voiceover actors from other series, from, you know, other shows. But the Vegas conventions are totally Star Trek. I mean, all the manifestations of Star Trek, Deep Space Nine, Enterprise, et cetera, et cetera.
Right.
And I did a cruise just recently when there were 3,000 Star Trek fans.
Right.
But I'll tell you, this is something that's
they're
still
amazing.
They're announcing
some big name that's
going to
be on the next cruise,
understand.
The lady at the sales booth said.
I resisted
tomorrow.
Going to Germany. I grew up in the 40s. I grew up during the Second World War. I grew up during concentration camps. And our coffee table book was photos from the concentration camps. So I grew up with a very strong anti-German sense. And it was just embedded in me. It was there. And I was sure it was there for life. I went to Germany. The morning of the first day, I got up and there was a breakfast, and there were like 200 young German fans. And the first thing I said was, no, I'm Jewish. And then I just went on. And I waited, there was no reaction. There was no freaking reaction. There was no blinking of the eye or,
oh my God, or Achtung, or,
you know, hi, you know. None of that. It was a different generation. And what it said to me, which I knew, but I had to really experience it, is that that kind of behavior that made Nazis and made the evil people, they're everywhere. We had genocide in the United States. We destroyed a whole race of people, Native Americans. We had slavery. Devastating things, but it's part of human nature. And the people who overcome it, who rise above it, are to be admired and to be thanked for letting themselves be exposed to the fact that there are good people everywhere, and as well as bad people. And to see this generation of Germans was just amazing. I should have known it was that way. Anyway, they've had me back every 5 years, and they love me there. It's just amazing. Except one guy. I went through the dealer's room before the convention opened, and there was a young man there, and said, "Mr. Koenig!" And I said, "Yes." He says, "How come there are no Germans on Star Trek?" He said, "We were the first ones who put rockets in the air." And I said, "Yeah, and you landed them on London."
No!
That was valid, but
true.
I'm particularly fond of going to German conventions.
All right, good job, Julie. Thank you. Your question.
Hi. I'm Emma from Milwaukee, Wisconsin, and I am a fellow alum of Grinnell College in Iowa, which is your alma mater.
Did we talk before?
We have not.
Okay. Is there somebody else here from Grinnell?
Oh, neat.
Yeah.
And my question is, do you have a favorite line of all time that you've said as Chekov?
As Chekov, or?
Yeah.
Oh, well, I guess, can you tell me where the nuclear was?
Okay.
Somebody else.
Chicago. I recently watched Gene Roddenberry's mid-70s TV movie, The Questor Tapes, which you have a cameo in. And in that cameo, you have a big, gorgeous mustache. So my first question, was that mustache real? And second question, any memories from the production of The Questor Tapes with Roddenberry in the 70s?
Are you sure I had a mustache?
Pretty confident.
Okay,
pretty
well,
good.
If,
pretty
if I
confident.
Had it, it was real. There was no other reason why I would be wearing it. I do remember that we had Bill was guest lead on it, Bill Shatner, and we had a really delightful, charming, extraordinarily stimulating, that's some bullshit. You never said a word. It's amazing. But no, that was okay. That was a good experience. We started at 3 in the afternoon on Columbo. We went till like 7 the next morning. And I worked long enough to make enough money to be able to get medical insurance through the Screen Actors Guild. So that's what I remember most about working on Columbo.
It's all about the benefits. Thank you very much. Another question.
Afternoon, sir. Welcome back home. My name's Gus, born and raised in Chicago, Logan Square neighborhood. Useless fact to think of the 9th or 10th time I met you, I had your autograph 3 times. You are my favorite Star Trek character. That's not bullshit.
Well done, sir.
First draft. which follow the outline very, very closely. When they called me and said, oh, we'd like you, our executive producer, who was an ex-Marine and was off shooting a two-hour Hulk at the time when I came in, he would like to talk to you. So I said, okay. So I came in, the two ladies were there, this gentleman was there. He says, we're gonna do your story, but we gotta change it. This could not happen in the United States. I said, well, I got it from a story about something that happened in the United States. He says, no, we gotta put it in Mexico. And I said, I can't do that. We put it in Mexico, because the story, I left that up, I neglected a very important element in the story, was the people there thought that the Hulk was a manifestation of the devil. And, which was an interesting perspective, you know, but they were so closeted and so away from what the rest of the world was. But I said, if we put this in Mexico, it's an indictment. We're saying that Mexicans are really, as a group, they're stupid and they're uneducated, and I can't do that. He said, well, if you can't do it, you can't do this script. And I said, okay, bye. Part for me. And it was a part of a guy who ends up in the captain's brain. It was a really good script. I was here at the time. I was in Chicago when it was being written, and I had my heart attack here. And other than my wife, the only other person I called was Joe Michael Straczynski, and said, I'm not going to be available to shoot that. I'm in the hospital, and I just had a quadruple bypass. He says, well, we'll try to hold the script for you. And I thought that was amazing. That doesn't happen in Hollywood. You don't have that kind of loyalty. As it turned out, they ran out of scripts. They literally had no more scripts than they had to write. But he said, I'll write you another part. I said, great. And I thought that was really the end of it. That's also Hollywood. You know, you get people who tell you things that never happen. You just learn to live with it. So I was amazed when I found out that he had written another script for me. And it was the part of Bester. And it was just not a one shot. It was a recurring character. And it became one of the highlights of my television career. I mean, I loved doing that character. Joe had a message for me. I haven't talked to Joe in a couple of years. And the message was, don't hunch.
Don't hunch.
I've never stood up straight in my life.
Thank you. Your question.
Hi, I'm Dan from Washington State. A few years back, you participated in a Star Trek fan film. I don't remember the title. But at the end of the film, Chekov got promoted to admiral. And I've asked a few questions on these panels and know about the stories. So did you ever have any ideas or maybe write any stories about what sort of adventures did the Captain Chekov or Admiral Chekov would go on?
No, because that was never important to me. I know it's important to George. George was, for many reasons, some of them are cultural. He felt the character needed to gain some stature. And, I mean, you could have put me in the brig and given me a 5-minute soliloquy, and I would have been ecstatic, you know? It didn't matter to me. It was the role, not the character. I mean, it was the character, but it was not the status of the character. It was not whether he was an ensign or a captain or an admiral. What was the question?
Just if you had imagined any further adventures for Chekov, it doesn't necessarily have to be captain or admiral, just that he happened to be promoted admiral in the movie.
Oh, well, just, you know, the thing that I always missed, and I think all the supporting actors would agree, is that we were there to help move the story along, but not for the purpose of the audience learning more about who we were. You know, it was expositional. We were there to help develop the story, but not to learn more about who we were. Now, Kirk McCoy and Spock, as the leads, you always learn something about them. You know, it was much more dimensional situation. So I missed that. I missed that opportunity. You know, I would say, Kipton, there's something out there. As their character, and not simply to push the story forward.
Thanks.
Thank you. Good question.
Yes. Good afternoon. My name is Stephen. I'm here in Chicago. This is my first convention, so forgive me if I'm sure you've answered this before, but it would be new to me and maybe other people here. You've led with Star Trek for more than half of your life. Obviously, it's been a huge part of it, as for many of us.
wanted to say. He's not going to say.
I can't go there.
He was in the 60s. Who knows?
Fair enough. Your question.
Season. So I had already had the advantage. Star Trek fans had been during the first season, that they were very vociferous, ambulatory, enthusiastic group of people who were committed to keeping Star Trek on the air. So I knew that foundation was already there. So I wasn't surprised to find that when I started actually participating and doing conventions and getting a mail. Although most of my mail was about how groovy I was. So my last little story. We're doing Star Trek, The Voyage Home. And there's a scene, you know, they divided up so we all had our individual scenes, which was terrific. I loved the idea, except for George. George got screwed. He had a scene that was set up, but the little kid he was supposed to work with was recalcitrant and wouldn't do the work and never got to shoot that scene. But there's a scene where Sulu and Scotty are walking down the street, if you recall. It's a live scene. It's a live scene with a real street. And they walk by a bar. And George had determined that he was going to look in the bar as part of his business, you know, before he went on further. So they rehearsed it. He looked in his bar. And this is 11 o'clock in the morning. And there's a young woman in the bar sitting on a stool. And she sees him in the window and waves to him. And then he walked away. And they did this about three times. And each time he came by and looked at the rehearsal, he looked in, she was there, and she waved. So on the fourth time, which was an action shot, action! And George comes by and looks in the window, and she goes. Oh, my.